So I move now to Jean-Louis for his presentation. Jean-Louis, the floor is yours.
Merci Thomas. Je vais commencer en français pour simplement dire que la façon dont j'aborde le cyber, c'est que le cyber est à la fois évidemment extrêmement lié à la cybersécurité, c'est-à-dire à l'ensemble des techniques et des analyses des attaques d'intrusion informatique, qu'elles soient à des fins d'espionnage ou de sabotage ou d'extorsion financière, mais est en même temps plus large et plus limité. En effet, pour moi, le cyber, c'est la continuation, pour paraphraser Clausewitz, la continuation de la politique par d'autres moyens. C'est une autre forme, une des formes modernes de la continuation de la politique par d'autres moyens, autre que la guerre. Parce que je vais effectivement me concentrer sur le cyber en temps de paix, qui est à mon avis le plus pernicieux, parce que le cyber en temps de guerre, qui est évidemment utilisé, par exemple les Américains ont neutralisé les défenses aériennes irakiennes au début de la guerre de 2003, mais il existe actuellement tous les moyens. Ceci s'intègre dans les défenses militaires. En revanche, le cyber en temps de paix correspond alors à une tendance qui se généralise actuellement et qu'on a vu hier, notamment lors du débat sur le lawfare, avec le très brillant exposé de la professeure Norodom, c'est atteindre des objectifs politiques et stratégiques sans combattre. Je vous rappelle que Sun Tzu, le père historique de la stratégie, a dit « Vaincre sans combattre est le comble du comble pour le stratège ». Et donc, c'est ce que nous allons essayer de discuter. Donc, je passe à l'anglais pour dire « What are... so if we do, once we have thus defined cyber, what are the main tools, vehicles to reach strategic goals through cyber? And there are, in fact, two main ways to do it that are more and more integrated and more perpetrated by the same aggressors. The first one is hacking, which is antagonistic penetration of IT networks in order to steal information, to sabotage, or to blackmail, to get a ransom, the so-called ransomware. So, but there is another way, which is to reach a political goal through a strategic goal through the manipulation of digital media. The most common way is manipulation of the major social media. And we have seen that, for example, in the 2016 election, a presidential election, where a number of so-called fake accounts, what the experts call sockets. It means accounts that were pretending to be black power partisans or white supremacists, but all based in the US, accounts on Facebook or on Twitter or on Instagram or YouTube. And in fact, they were manipulated. It has never been really denied, by the Internet Research Agency of St. Petersburg, which is just, president of Russia said that there was absolutely no link between this organization and the US government. And he mentioned, as well as the US government pretends that he has no links with the various NGOs that have been interfering in Russian domestic politics. And so it's one way, manipulation of social media, and the extraordinary power of social media makes this way very, very effective. And new ways, because the digital media are not limited to social media. And there is a new, for example, digital video is a digital media. It could be transmitted not only by social media, but on TV, movies, etc. And there is a new technology, a new tool that is extraordinarily effective, more and more effective, called the deepfake, which is the constitution of totally fake videos, but that cannot be or are very difficult now. And each month, it's very recent, started really in 2016. Each month, it's better. You know, there is a kind of a competition between various research centers, not mentioning the bad guys. And it is impossible to distinguish, and in an electoral campaign, it could be very effective. And we could have a video of Thierry de Montbrial here in Marrakech having a discussion with one of the VIP present here and plotting some major operation to against the French president, for example. And it could be, it will be you as you are now and with your voice. Impossible to differentiate. So we have to face that. So manipulation, so you see here we have a total integration of the traditional fake news of through the social media and of hacking because it is a digital technique. So, and it uses, for the experts, it uses new tools, very recent tool of deep learning and artificial intelligence called generative adversarial networks. You know. Les réseaux adverses antagonistes génératifs en français. So, what to do? What has been the various strategies to react to these threats? And here we have, in terms of major powers, they have different emphasis. The Americans, for many years, have mainly focused on intelligence, to collect every possible data, far more than they can process. But they wanted to know everything. And this has been denounced by Snowden, as you know, with the excesses that we know, since the NSA was trying to get informed on the private discussions of the chancellor discussing the menu of a dinner with her husband, or and also to penetrate the information center, information system of the Elysee. You know. So all of that has been, in my view, a little clearly excessive, not very friendly. But while the Americans were focusing mainly on intelligence, other powers were focusing on manipulation of information, and they started earlier. And so this explained the strategic surprise and of the Americans while they found the situation to which they were confronted in 2016. The Russians and the Chinese, as very early the beginning of the 2000, even the late 1990s, understood the ability of cyber, both through hacking and through social media manipulation, a little later social media manipulation, to gain strategic advantage. And they have done that with different ways. The Russians are very bright, very brilliant. I don't think they are spending enormous resources. By the way, the Russian defense budget, it was the most cost-effective of the world. You know. You know that France and Germany together, their budget is clearly above the Russian defense budget. You know. I don't think that we have exactly the same military effectiveness for a variety of reasons. So the Russians are very cost effective and they are very cost effective in cyber and they are very good brains. You know. The Chinese are using just the mass.
Sure. Yeah, if you can.
Sure.
Yeah, okay. Conclude.
So the Chinese are focusing on intelligence and the hierarchy of powers is different because you have quantity and you have Russians and the Americans. It means you have high quality people and in large numbers. And you have large numbers with a little less quality than Chinese. You have a small country like Israel, which is a major cyber power in terms of brands.
That's
a so now
transition.
To conclude, I want to note. The threat is rising, and I know that Mr. Chetrit will demonstrate that. And for that, we need two things to face these growing threats because the more we digitalize our companies, and here I slightly disagree with Patrick in the sense that the more we digitalize, the more vulnerable we are. And to face the threat, the private companies alone cannot face them, because only the states have the intelligence, because threat intelligence is essential. If you don't know who attacks you, you cannot protect yourself. Not only you cannot respond, but you cannot protect yourself. And so in growing interaction between French, the national or international style, like European agencies of agencies, and private companies is necessary. It is necessary to have a doctrine not of deterrence. Deterrence in cyber is meaningless, because deterrence is no war. You don't fight because you know that should you fight, it will be mutual annihilation. In cyber, you have to demonstrate daily your capability. Technology is evolving. So it is not deterrence in cyber, and we may discuss that. It's a continuous, I would say, reactive defense. You have to identify your adversary and to punish it, not to escalate, to demonstrate that you know who the adversary is, and to punish it, to punish him. And so this is essential. If we don't have that, we are paralyzed. Just to give you an example concerning all European countries.
Maybe we can.
Yes, one word. Listen.
The example maybe for the Q&A session, if you don't mind.
Sure, I will. Just to say, but it's a major threat. And you have to know that in the European infrastructures, growing numbers of so-called prepositionings. It means implants. It means all style state-manipulated hacking in order to prepare future attacks, but which means that our energy infrastructure are vulnerable, have been noticed, and they are growing. They are not because these nations are preparing war against Europe. It is just to intimidate and to tell our leaders, you know, we can just cut power supply, electricity, for 24 hours, you know, as it has happened in some countries in Europe recently. You know, we know, on the east in Europe. So this is a major challenge. We need real defense. We Europeans to do far more than we are doing. And we need an international organization to deal with cyber risks that are growing. And this is what President Macron started to launch with his appeal for peace and for security and trust in cyberspace almost 1 year ago during the Paris Peace Forum.
Thank you very much, Jean-Louis. I'm sorry, but I want to give the chance to Mayor. I think you prefer to speak at the podium. I thought during your statement, there is a point of debate between Patrick and Jean-Louis about the role of companies. So very briefly, maybe on that, could you elaborate? You know, because
if you want to do it now, or
yeah, yes, please do.
Very rapidly, to complement on threat intelligence. You're right; it's a very critical aspect. So we have collaboration with a state agency, France is ANSSI, that is providing us some information, CGHQ in the UK as well. It's not available everywhere. India, we have 110,000 people, I have zero information. But this is complemented by the industry. We have our own large companies, such as Microsoft, Cisco, IBM, that process billions of events per day, are providing us with intelligence on the characteristic of a different attack. We have a partnership, an industry partnership that has been launched by Brad Smith, the General Counsel of Microsoft, called TechAccor, that is here to bring together, there are about 60 companies where we sit together and we exchange best practices and intelligence, because ultimately it's a cost of doing business for us. There is no competitive advantage to gain. And for the fun part, there is a Hacker Super League. So you can look, you're informed. So today I can tell you the group called Russian Bear is the number one in the Super League, because they can penetrate and migrate in a system in 30 minutes, and the number two needs 2 hours and a half. So this is how it's crazy, but that's the way it works. So yes, we need the state, but the industry and the enterprise are developing their own means.
We'll let Jean-Louis respond to that after the presentation by Mayor.